Hi guys, and welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, my name is Julia Levesque, and I have my husband Josh here with me again today.
Guys.
And if you hear a dog down here, our dog is here, very nosy. But anyways, today's video is going to be our engagement story. If you watched not the last video, the video before that, we talked about how we met and what led up to us dating. So we thought we would do a series upon that video and do today's video on our engagement story, and then later on in the next few videos, it'll be our wedding story, and we'll talk about all the planning, our original plans, and
how things changed,
how long our engagement was. Actually, we'll touch on that today. But yeah, so Gunner, you good? All right, so if you watched two videos ago, we had said we had ended up with where did we end up on?
I think after our first, I agreed to go to lunch with you.
Yeah. So if you saw that video, I turned him down, and 2 weeks later, after much pushing and meddling from my mother-in-law, my mother, and my grandmother, I ended up asking him out again, and he said yes, and we went out on our first date. And where was our first date?
Right next to where you worked.
Yeah, it was a restaurant right across from my office. It was a real casual date, actually. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like a formal dinner date or anything, dinner and a movie. That was actually our second date. Mm-hmm. So it was super casual. We talked, you know, the basic first date stuff. You know, where do you, like, see yourself in a few years? Where do you, like, what do you want to do? That kind of stuff.
Where did you go to school? What interests you? What are your hobbies?
Yeah.
Basically everything that we didn't talk about while we were at work.
Yeah. So, and I had actually told him that I was moving back up to Alaska in April. And, I mean, that was that. I thought just one lunch, give him a chance, let him know, hey, these are my plans. I don't plan on staying around here. I'd been here for almost a year. By the time I would have moved back up to Alaska, it would have been almost a full year here. Gave it a chance. I thought it was a place I was going to stay. Didn't feel that way. Little did I know. And then our second date, it was more formal. It was a dinner and a movie. You want to talk a little bit about that?
That was not much to say. We went to dinner and saw a movie.
And I was pushing for him to hold my hand. And I was dropping all the hints. You know, I was, you know, getting closer to him at the movies, and we watched a scary movie. It was It. We went and saw It in theaters.
Which, for the record, I hate horror movies, but she chose, and I wasn't going to let her know that I hate horror movies, so.
Well, you gave me a few options of what was playing, and
I think It was actually really the only thing that was even remotely interesting.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah.
To the point of holding her hand, I was brought up to be a
gentleman.
A straight shooting gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't think on our first formal date, even being no longer kids, that it wouldn't be right to be presumptuous and hold her hand. So I was just attempting to be a gentleman in that regard.
Yeah, and I don't know if we had said this in the previous video. By the time that we started dating, I was, what, 23?
Yes.
I was 23.
Four. And three.
I was 23, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you were?
Old.
29.
Eight.
28. We're 5.5 years apart. He's older than me, obviously. So, you know, we weren't, you know, young adults. And then we just kind of, we saw each other more and more. And I think it was actually by the second date, I knew that, all right, this guy is the one for me. And I had always told myself, once I met my future husband, I would know, because I did not want to date just for fun. I always had the intention of dating for marriage. That's just, it was my upbringing. I grew up in a Christian home. He grew up in a Christian home too. So we knew that we didn't want to, you know, have fun. We obviously wanted to have fun, but, you know, not in that sense of just, you know, casual. We didn't want to casually date.
That makes it sound real good, doesn't it?
Yeah.
We want a relationship, but we didn't want to have a fun relationship.
They know what I mean. Anyway, so I had told him by either like the second or the third date, he's back there, that, you know, I see us, you know, in it for the long haul. I probably scared him by saying that.
Nope.
I don't, Actually, I don't even remember my exact words. I just remember saying, I'm not going to move back up to Alaska.
Are you talking about on our third date, or third, second official date, third, like,
yes.
overall date?
Yes.
We were driving to...
It was Portland, wasn't it?
South Portland. Yeah. We were just going to walk around.
Yeah.
Walk downtown,
around the old
see
port.
The old port. Yep. And,
yeah.
So
we if you're from Maine,
I
mean, yeah, we live in Maine, so we were going down to Portland, and it's called the Old Port, and right by the ocean, and we were just going to walk around to look at the shops. Possibly,
super casual, nothing,
yeah.
No, we didn't really have any plans. We said if we were hungry,
mm-hmm.
we'd grab dinner, but we
yeah.
just were going to literally go down there and walk around and hang out. It was a beautiful day and beautiful night. And
mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so I had told him I'm not going to move back up to Alaska. I think that this is where God is telling me I need to, you know, settle roots and, you know, get married and have our own family. And the drive up...
Oh. Mind you, this was, I think, less than 2 weeks after our first official lunch date.
Mm-hmm.
She was telling me this, that she was changing her entire life plans to stay with me.
Yes.
Which, like, no pressure, but...
And so many women today would be like, are you crazy? You're changing your entire life plans for some guy? Yes. I am not a feminist whatsoever, as you can tell. Anyways, and yeah, that's our drive up down to Old Port. It was, I think, a 45-minute drive from my house, so we
mm-hmm.
talked a lot, and we talked really serious, heavy stuff. It wasn't casual. It was like nitty gritty. Like, what do you want to do? And I had told him, you know, if we were to get married. I remember throughout that entire night, it was always if we were to get married.
Yeah.
Even though I had just said I'm not moving back up to Alaska because, you know, I want to get married, but I thought, I mean, I don't want to like completely freak him out. Anyways, I said, you know, once I get married and once we start having kids, my intention is to be a stay-at-home mom, and I do want to homeschool our kids. And that's still the plan. Obviously, right now, I'm not a stay-at-home mom. That's our goal, and that's what we're working towards,
right.
So we can be financially stable to be in that position. And he's like, that's perfect. I've always... You go ahead and you tell. I don't want to
speak
for you.
I was wondering if you were going to let me jump back in.
Sorry.
No, which worked out to be really well, because in my mind, I'd grown up on a farm. Both of my parents worked, but my mother worked nights at a restaurant. My dad worked days. So there was always a parent home. And in my mind, I had always kind of pictured my wife being a stay-at-home mom. Like Julia said, we're not in that situation right now, unfortunately. But that is our goal. That is what we are working towards. And when she...
Only a few more years.
Yeah, and she had said several times during... Well, first of all, we were having such a good time talking that we actually drove right by the exit
mm-hmm.
that we were supposed to take, and I started seeing signs for New Hampshire, and it's like, I think we were supposed to take an exit back there.
Saco,
so
New Hampshire, Kidder's like, wait.
Yeah. I think we need to turn around and go back a few exits.
Mm-hmm.
But no, we were talking, and she did say a few times that, you know, I don't want to freak you out or scare you, and in my mind, when she said that she wasn't moving back to Alaska, it wasn't a, I've made this huge change, you're trapped. We have to get married. It was, I am serious about the.
Sorry.
It was more, I am serious about this relationship. I'm not somebody who's going to take this relationship lightly. Let's give this a chance and see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
So in my mind, that's where we were at, which was fine because I thought, still think Julia is terrific and amazing. And I can't believe that, you know, I've had that thought all through our dating, engagement, and still to this day, I can't believe she's with me because she's such an amazing person.
He trapped me. After that, we didn't go out to eat. We just kept walking around Old Port. I think there was actually, wasn't there something going on? I thought there was something going on, and like we couldn't get into a restaurant the way...
Oh, there was a restaurant down there called Duck Fat, and they were closed for renovations.
Oh, okay.
Actually. But that was
yeah.
the place that we had. We had friends. Well, as we said, we worked in a restaurant, so we had a lot of friends in the restaurant industry.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the salesmen had actually told us about this place, and it sounded phenomenal. So
mm-hmm.
we wanted to check it out, and we said if we were hungry, we would go there. You know, if there was an hour wait for a table, we would just walk around. But turns out the place was closed for renovations at the time, so that plan went out the window. Thankfully, neither of us were that hungry, so no harm, no foul.
And I was too nervous to eat because we had really deep discussions. And whenever we have a deep discussion, at least for me, like I get not butterflies in my stomach, but I'm just too nervous to eat. So fast forward to a few dates, but we really got serious about our relationship and we really started talking about getting married. And
well, we kind of settled into the regular, you know, the typical dating routine.
Yes.
Where we were texting each other, mm-hmm. or talking every day, and
we were always
going
talking.
Out a couple, you know, at least a couple dates a week. We were seeing each other at work all the time, and
mm-hmm.
it was at this point common knowledge that we were a
except
couple.
At the restaurant, not everybody knew that we were dating at the very beginning, and it was actually his dad who
let it slide. I forgot all about that.
Who let it? He didn't let it slip, but he just announced.
He started talking about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, he announced it, and everybody's like, "Wait, what? They're dating?" And then after that, everybody found out, and they were like, "How long have you guys been dating?" And it's like
all the typical
yeah.
questions when you're
yeah, but they were
out.
Just surprised that it took everybody at the work that long to find out. Which we were really good at. We weren't intentionally hiding it. We just didn't flaunt it. We were there to do a job. You know, started dating, got into the routine, and by that point, it had been 6 weeks
yeah.
of us dating.
4 or 5 weeks.
Mm-hmm. And by that point, I was still living at home because I was going to school in this weird transition of I'm not going to school, I'm working full-time, but, you know, this is the guy I'm going to marry, dating him. So it was a weird transition. And by that point, my dad was taking on a contract job that would require him to go to a different country. And he would be gone for a full year. I was like, "Josh, like, I don't want a long dating period. I don't want a long engagement. My dad is leaving in like 4 days. You need to talk to him."
Now, mind you, again, I was raised very old school. And in this day and age, some people think that the whole tradition of asking a father for his daughter's hand in marriage is antiquated and misogynistic. But I knew we knew each other's families. We knew that we both had very similar upbringing, so I knew it wasn't going to be a problem, and I fully intended to talk to her father about marrying her before I proposed. Mm-hmm. But not in my wildest dream did I think at the I think it was about 5.5 weeks in after our first date, we were talking, Julia was saying that you need to talk to him before he leaves. So I ended up going, and I think it was almost 6 weeks to the day. I sent her dad a text. This was the day before he left, because I couldn't get away from work and stuff to find time to get down there to talk to him. It was the day before he left, and he was packing, and I sent him a text saying, "Hey, can I come and talk to you for a few minutes? It shouldn't take too long." And he just said, "Yep," which
he... Okay, he wasn't... My family was not blindsided towards any of this, to the fact that Josh was the person I was going to marry. It was common knowledge.
It was 6 weeks. In my mind, no father says, I don't care how old the guy is and how old the daughter is, no father says yes to a guy asking to marry his daughter after only 6 weeks of dating. I think I had dinner with her family like 3 times. He couldn't probably pick me out of a lineup at that point.
Anyways, I just wanted to throw out that it was my family was not being blindsided. My dad knew it was coming and knew that I wanted to marry him. So I just wanted to throw that out there before Josh continued.
So anyway, I went, it was snowing that day, it was really cold because we live in Maine and that's what happens in Maine. It snows 9 months out of the year and it's cold 10 months out of the year. And I was a few minutes early, so I parked in a nearby parking lot and prayed really hard for about 10 minutes. Drove up and went in. I was super nervous, can't really remember much of the conversation until I actually, he said, "You can breathe now, you've done fine." He asked me a series of questions. Can't really remember what most of them were.
Mind you, I was out of the house. My mom was out of the house and my sister was out.
Yep.
So it was just my dad there. I think we went to go pick up my brother from school.
Maybe.
Yep.
Yeah, I think school was canceled because mm-hmm. of the snowstorm. Or the early release or something.
It was early release. I remember I stayed home sick because, you know, lady issues that time of the month type of thing. So I was not at work.
Yep. So he did say yes. Which, if he had said no, I would have respected that. But he said yes, and then something kind of funny happened with the carload of Julia and her family. If you want to
yes.
share that
so,
a little.
My dad, he went up to my mom's like, "Hey," he was being all serious this day.
I thought he called you or texted you.
No, this is before. So
oh.
We're still at the house. And my dad knew it was happening. I'm the firstborn. I'm his first daughter. You get the picture, right? He goes up to my mom, hey, you girls need to get out of the house. And my mom's like, why? Why are you telling me to leave? She's like, Josh
it's
called me.
It's gonna be a murder.
Josh called me. He wants to talk. You know what this means, right? So me, my mom, and my sister are all giddy because, you know, in my 23-year-old mind, like, of course he was going to say yes. Why would he say no? Like, no was not even an option. It wasn't even on my radar. I just had, yeah, he's going to say, of course he's going to say yes. So I was like, why wouldn't he?
I totally forgot to bring that up. When we had talked about this at work prior to me going and talking to her dad, that was the first thing out of my mouth was, he's not going to say yes. And she said, what do you mean he's not going to say yes? Of course he's going to say yes.
And I remember this conversation very vividly because he was at the wash station. Okay, so at the wash station, you have a door and you go upstairs to the second floor. And I was waiting tables on the second floor that night. And I had a tray of French onion soup. And I'm like hurrying because it's very heavy. He's like, hey, what if your dad says no? I'm thinking, no, it's not an option. He's going to say yes. And I just went upstairs.
And of course, in my mind, all I'm thinking is, it's been less than 6 weeks. He's going to say no. And she was and I tried everything in my power to hammer into her mind that he was going to say no. Because it was, in my mind, it wasn't just a possibility. It was guaranteed he was going to say no.
And in my mind, it was guaranteed he was going
to
say yes.
And she was completely oblivious to the fact that a no could be the answer.
Here's the thing. I had my mom on my side. I had my grandmother on my side. Like, why would my dad say no?
And
anyways,
if I put myself in his shoes, I would have said no. So
yeah, having a daughter now, I'd be like, oh, what guy in their right mind would dare to ask that? Like, no. Anyways, so we go ahead and we leave and we go pick up my brother. And we were waiting at the school and my mom, I think, either got a text or a phone call. I can't quite remember.
It was a phone call.
Okay, it was a phone call. And my dad's like, hey, Josh just left. And we knew what he was asking. So my mom's like, so, John, like, what did you say? My dad's like, I told him no. Are you crazy? And my mom was livid at him. Livid. And I remember driving, and I was in the driver's seat. My sister was in the... I can't remember where my sister was, but I just remember I was in the driver's seat. My mom was not very happy with my dad because we all knew, like, Josh was... He was it. He was the person I was supposed to marry. And so she hung up with him. She's like, I'm so mad at your father right now. And it was just like going off on how she couldn't believe he said no. And I'm livid at him. I'm like, I'm not talking to him when I get home. I'm just going to ignore him and just give him the cold shoulder.
No, and mind you, during this time, I had never sent Julia a message saying that I had left her parents' house and that I had finished talking to her dad because I was thanking God that I'd made it through the conversation in one piece and that he had said yes, and just being very I think I took another 10 or 15 minutes just praying and giving thanks for that. So I hadn't had a chance to send a message saying, hey, everything went great. So they were without any lifeline of what was really going on.
Yeah. And I actually can't remember if he called
back. No, he sent you a text, I think, just saying, kidding.
Oh, okay.
This is how I remember you telling me the story.
If I had told him, then I told him correctly. Mom brain and a lot has happened within 3 years.
Yeah.
So he sent my mom a text, like, I'm just kidding. I said yes to him. And I remember all of us just shrieking with excitement. And it was before my brother got it. Hold on, I need to let my cat inside. So he sent us a text, said yes. We all shrieked. We were so excited. I was so giddy. I'm like, finally I can start planning, like officially start planning the wedding, because I had kind of started
planning. Actually talked about a few things about the wedding already.
Yeah, I remember looking at David's bridal and just like kind of getting a vision of what I wanted my wedding dress to look like. This was before we officially got engaged, before I even talked to my dad. And I happened to find like the perfect veil. I wanted a cathedral style veil, super long, super just not bougie, but just like it was very classy and it was on sale. So I remember thinking, like, am I crazy for getting it right now? We're not even engaged. She hasn't talked to my dad, but I know we're gonna get engaged and I'm gonna be really mad at myself if I don't buy it. So I bought it, and that was the first official wedding thing I ever got before we got engaged. So anyways, we get home, I'm super excited. My mom is just ecstatic. She's so happy. And talking to my dad and just like greeting him when I got home, something, it definitely shifted our relationship ever so slightly, because at that moment he knew that he only had this amount of time of me being quote unquote his little girl until I was somebody else's.
Well, that's sad.
It is sad.
I never really thought of that.
The same was gonna happen to you with Eleanor.
Shh.
It was a little different, but not in a bad way. It was just our relationship had changed a little bit because I was soon going to be under somebody else's care and somebody else's roof and somebody else's responsibility and not my dad's. Yeah. And then after he talked to my dad took on the contract job and left. And how long had it been until we continued to date, obviously, and he was working behind the scenes on planning the engagement, and I remember pestering him and pestering my sister.
So I ended up talking to her sister, because Julia and her sister are extremely tight, and I couldn't really come out and just ask Julia what she wanted for a ring and what she liked for ring styles, and being a guy, I have no idea what a nice ring setting is.
Mm-hmm.
So I spent quite a bit of time talking to her sister about potential ring ideas, and I managed to, this was fast forwarding, we'll just fast forward to the actual engagement, like when
okay.
I proposed, and this would have been
four
months after I had talked to your dad.
So we started officially dating October 2nd,
mm-hmm.
That was our first date. And you had talked to my dad 6 weeks later, and we got engaged mid-January.
So mid-November, December. So 2 months. It was 2 months from when I talked to her dad to when I actually proposed.
Mm-hmm.
And what I, like I said, worked pretty closely with Julia's sister to get this all worked out. And what I ended up doing was obviously got the ring. I had a custom ring made for her. And we had been going to my family's church. So I thought, and Julia had always said that she wanted her proposal, or the proposal, to be somewhere. She said outdoors, which it was January. I didn't think outdoors was really going to work.
There was snow everywhere. Yeah.
We had a lot of snow that year. It was cold. Just outdoors was out of the question. But the other big thing that she said was, I want family to be around. I want a lot of family to be around. So I worked, have you used your sister's name?
I said Mickey.
Okay, so Kat just moved the camera stand a little bit. I'd been talking to Mickey and trying to coordinate getting all of Julia's side of the family to the church on that day.
I have a lot of family.
And she has a lot of family.
If the camera moves,
yeah, the cat's rubbing up
against the tripod. Gosh, John.
We have so many pets.
It's a farm. What do you expect?
Anyway, I had been working pretty closely with Mickey to coordinate, get all the family from her side there. I told my side, and no one in the family is really well known for being able to keep secrets. So
I have to give my sister props for, you know,
yeah.
basic planning from the very beginning with him. And I was hounding her all the time. I'm like, when is Josh going to propose? Like, does he have a ring yet? She did not crack. So I'm giving her major props.
Way to go, Mickey.
Mm-hmm.
Still, great job with that.
Yes.
So anyway, we got the whole family coordinated, and I'd been picking Julia up, and we'd been driving to church together on Sunday mornings.
Mm-hmm.
Well, on this particular Sunday, I was always running late. It's kind of a joke that my family runs late. And I'd intentionally run a little extra late that day, and the plan was that Mickey was going to get Julia's mom and family to go to their church, because they go to a different church usually, and they actually went to our church along with the grandparents and everyone else. And, excuse me, on the way, I also planned it so my car was extremely low on gas. I think actually the low fuel light came on.
I think you were at like 0 miles.
Yeah,
mile.
So
like,
the low fuel light came on.
Talk about anxiety.
And I told Julia, look, I know that we're late for church already. I need to get gas because this car might run out of gas before we make it back here to the gas station. So that was just buying a little more time to let the family get there. And I had picked you up a coffee too that morning.
Yes, and
from Duncan.
And my sister actually told me the night before, she's like, hey, we're going to take family photos and send them off
That's
to Dad,
right.
so make sure
Dress nice.
Dress nice and tell me what you're going to wear so we can kind of coordinate. So I was like, all right, sweet. So good job, Mick.
So, yeah, I think we had actually talked. Yeah, Mickey had bounced that idea off of me. So, again, good job, Mick.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so we're running late. We're like 5 minutes or so late. And I had actually talked. I'm pretty good friends. Not good friends, but I know the pastor at our church. And I had told him what was going on. And he actually, there was two services at that point at our church. And the morning service had let out. And at this point, my family and Julia's family, there's probably, what, 25 family members?
There's a lot of people.
In the entryway of the church. And people were coming out of the other service saying, what's going on? And they heard that there was going to be a proposal. So then we had just random people from the church in this big semicircle around the entryway to the church building.
Mm-hmm.
And we had actually one of our friends in the car with us. And I had the ring in my inside coat pocket. And I'm trying to, Julia's walking ahead of me into the church building.
Because we're
thinking we're running late, so she's hustling.
I'm like, I hate being late. It's my biggest pet peeve. It's gotten a little better since marrying him
because we're
always late. And then having a baby, I'm like, that's my excuse. Like, I'm always late now.
So anyway, Julia's hustling. I've got my coffee and her coffee because she was carrying her purse. I hand them off to our friend, and her name was Riley, is Riley. And I'm fishing in my pocket for the ring. I pulled it out. Julia walks in, completely oblivious to all the people. And I'm pretty sure she went, oh, what are you doing here?
Because
she saw cameras and she saw...
I saw the first person I remember seeing was my mom. I'm like, why is my mom here? She said she was going to her church. And I started looking around and I see my sister. I see both grandmothers. And I see a whole bunch of people. I don't remember. It's all a blur. The faces
are a blur. Your sister was holding a camera so your dad could FaceTime in on the...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my dad was on FaceTime watching the proposal.
Yep. And so she turns around, and at that point it dawns on her what's happening.
Yeah,
I'm
like,
on one knee, and I asked her to marry me. Basically, I said, it's been a roller coaster of a ride. It's happened quickly, but I know that you're the person I want to spend my life with, and would you do me the honor of being my wife? To which she obviously said yes.
I said no at first.
You did?
No, I didn't.
I was like, I don't remember that.
He had this whole big speech, and he kept continuing on, and I kept saying yes, yes, yes.
The speech was all of 20 seconds.
I know, but in my mind, like, I knew. I don't know if other girls do this, but as soon as, like, you see the ring, and they're still mid-sentence
yes,
of
yes,
asking.
Yes, 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 yes.
Like, you start saying yes, because... First of all, you want to wear that ring. It was a huge blur. It was a very emotional time. I remember taking the phone that was being used to FaceTime my dad and going out and talking to him and then going back in. And then everything else from that day was just a blur. I don't remember it.
We went and had lunch with your mom and Mickey. And.
Oh, yep, we did. And my grandma.
Yep.
And I think we just spent the rest of the day with each other. We went to a few stores.
I think so. I can't really remember. Honestly can't remember.
I can't remember.
But yeah, that's the engagement story.
Mm-hmm.
Or the proposal story.
Yeah. I could actually show you guys my ring because he did get it custom made.
Oh, that was one thing. I did ask her what her ring size was because I wanted to be right and not have to have it resized because I had a platinum band made. And
we had discussed getting platinum before we were engaged.
So I did know that. And I had a platinum band made. And she told me it was 7.5. So I got a 7.5 size band. And it's not 7.5.
I didn't really.
She was wrong.
Okay, so I don't know much about jewelry. I don't know anything about diamonds, that kind of stuff. That's not me. I didn't realize that the thinner the band, the smaller the size you need to get.
Which would make sense. They'd make the circumference, the inner circumference, stay the same. But
yeah, so it's bigger on me, but here. So.
Closer.
I'm focusing.
There it is.
There it is. And I don't know if you guys can see. It's not raised too much. Just enough. I didn't want the diamond to be too big and have it catch on stuff. But obviously I didn't want it too small. And I think it's just under a carat, if I remember correctly.
It's just north of 3/4 of a carat.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's perfect. I love it. I love that he had it custom made. But yeah, I don't think there's anything else to the story.
No. It worked out. We're married.
Yes. Yeah. All right. So that is how we got engaged, what led up to our engagement, and our engagement story. I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and we will be doing part 3, and I think it will be the final part as our wedding story and planning and all that stuff, what changed, what didn't change.
What we originally set out to have, what we ended up having, fun little coincidences.
Yeah, we planned for a smaller wedding, but...
Piece of advice, the wedding you set out to have is never the wedding that you actually have.
Exactly, and that's okay. Totally okay, you gotta roll with it. Anyways, I hope you guys enjoyed today's video, and we'll see you guys next time.